Coming up on Need to Know, the opt-out movement connected to what's being called high-stakes testing is far from over. Locally in the media, we've heard about the issue in suburban districts. Now we learn how city school parents are getting involved and who's helping their effort. Also on the show, two worlds collide as art and bicycles join forces in a new exhibit with a local twist. And area filmmakers focus on the environmental issues of our time in a debut Rochester Film Festival. It's all coming up right now on Need to Know. Backlash against common core testing across the country and in our community is at a high point right now. Not only are parents taking to social media and school board meetings to voice their concerns and anger, teachers' unions are now joining in and expressing their opposition to what some call high-stakes testing, which is supposed to measure student progress. New York's largest teachers union is actually encouraging parents to boycott the upcoming math and English language arts exams for students in third through eighth grade. Districts are responding in varied ways, but how is the Rochester City School District responding now that some teachers in the district are publicly taking a stand against the tests? And what about students? What are their thoughts on this contentious issue? Joining me for this discussion is Adele Bovar, Deputy Superintendent for Administration with the City School District, Chris Widmeyer, a teacher at World of Inquiry School, and Bronwyn Wilkinson, a senior at World of Inquiry School. And thank you all for joining me. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
So this opt-out movement, you know, really began gaining momentum last spring, and it seemed as though parents were fueling the efforts and really leading this effort, and suburban parents, as I mentioned in particular. And now we hear about it in the city school system and also suburban districts throughout Rochester, but more so teachers are becoming more prominent and speaking out about this. And I want to go to you, Chris, because you're one of those teachers publicly taking a stand. And why come forward now as opposed to last year or 2 years ago?
I think that one of the things that we wanted to do as teachers is make sure that our stand was based on evidence and that we were able to analyze the results and how the Common Core is being implemented. I think that the Common Core standards are a good idea, and that the idea behind them, that they are going to raise the expectations for all students and what they need to know and make them college and career ready, is a great idea. But then looking at these tests and how they're being used as more than just measures of student achievement and being used for teacher evaluation has kind of changed things. And also the kind of data that they're creating is not very helpful for teachers to improve.
What is that data?
The data really is a test score that is not, the tests are not released to the teachers, so the teachers are not able to see data about which specific questions the students got right or wrong. And it's really, my understanding is broken down to a 1, 2, 3, and a 4 scale for individual students. Whereas for the Regents exam, we get data that breaks down how every student did on each question. We can see by our school how different questions are being answered and which standards are being met well and not well for students. And in my own practice, you know, I can give students some sort of pre-assessment before I teach something and a post-assessment afterwards. And the Common Core is not giving that data to teachers. So it's hard to use it as a meaningful measure and a way to improve education for an individual student.
And just to clarify, because I interviewed you about a year ago, and mm-hmm. I did a story package for Need to Know, navigating different perspectives of the Common Core and what people viewed as the pros and the cons, and you were in support of the Common Core. So I just want to make sure this mm-hmm. is really about differentiating the Common Core assessments versus the Common Core standards.
Absolutely.
Okay. All right. Well, I want to go to you, Adele, because parent backlash, you know, against statewide assessments is not new for the city school district and most districts in our area, and there are ramifications when students do not show up to take the test. And so how does the district respond when teachers join the effort and publicly take a stand against assessments and work with parents just so they are aware of the necessary steps they need to take to opt their child out if they want to?
The district feels it's important to have all sides and all perspectives understood. So we want to be clear with the parents that in Rochester City, we do support our parents and we do listen carefully to our parents. And if our parents do have concerns about the test, we want them to come in and talk about those with their principals. But we also want them to understand that Rochester is in a different situation than the suburban districts. So there is an impact to our district because we have so many schools in Rochester that are considered low performing in the accountability status, and they need to demonstrate progress. And School 58 is a wonderful school, a wonderful new facility, fabulous teachers, and they are in a focus designation. And in order to show progress and to get to good standing, they need to have a certain amount of students participate in their test. So it's important that parents know that and they know the correct information about the tests.
Well, Bronwyn, I'm interested in your perspective because this nationwide dialogue and also here locally, it's supposed to be about you, the student. And, you know, we're not talking about refusing the Common Core Regents exam because that's a graduation requirement. But I want to know, you know, you can provide some insight in terms of how this dialogue and the influx of it how contentious this issue has become. How is it affecting students in your school and student learning?
Well, I have a friend who is in 10th grade this year, and so he's actually taken a lot more of the Common Core tests than I have. And I know he doesn't like them. He finds that the material is kind of more than the teachers either can go over or have gone over. And I know teachers don't like the style of testing that it is. Like, I haven't heard a lot of good things about Common Core. My mom is an educator, and so she's been helping prepare kids for Common Core tests. And she finds that it's harder to prepare for than maybe like the previous Regents exams were. So just the style of questions don't work as well for as many kids.
Well, this week, the president of the state's largest teachers union, the New York State United Teachers, urged parents to opt their kids out of testing. The Rochester Teachers Association has come out in support of parents opting their kids out. And Chris, there are some who will argue that the stance of unions and teachers publicly speaking out about testing in particular is self-serving, given the fact that there's this link between teacher evaluations and testing. I want to know, how would you respond to that? Is that what it's about for you, or what's the mission behind this?
Mm-hmm. So I think my response to that is that as teachers, we are stewards of education, and that individual students and their success is what we're concerned about. And there's a development of a deep trust between teachers and students and the parents. And the parents trust that what we're asking their students to do is in the individual student's best interest. And, you know, a lot of teachers have come to the conclusion and that asking students to take these tests is not in their best interest. You know, if you are an eighth grader with special needs, you can spend at least 8 hours taking this exam, which can be an extremely traumatizing experience for a student. So, you know, looking at the individual student and letting that override any other things, that these are, you know, this can be a terrible experience. And for a student that has a lot of test anxiety, it's not necessarily going to measure what they actually know, which is the goal of any good test.
Ron, when you have a podcast, it's called School Stew, and I mm-hmm. listened to a recent episode, and you talked about standardized learning, and you also talked about standardized testing, and you said it's likely not going to go away anytime soon, but you said it's okay because we need a baseline to measure student achievement, and you actually proposed that schools find ways to help students perform better on assessments. And given what Chris just said, as a student, you're the ideal person to really suggest ways in which to do this, so what would you suggest?
Well, as far as preparing students for tests, I know a lot of classrooms and a lot of teachers, they have like kind of a set way that they teach, and I've seen how this doesn't always work for students, like especially if they just learn differently. So the thing that I really support is just presenting things in different ways, so like maybe more than one way, and like having one of the ways be more creative, just because I know a lot of students who are more like creatively minded, so like taking notes wouldn't necessarily work for them. And I do feel like that if standardized tests are just too in depth into some material, like it really takes away from the teacher being able to present things like as deeply as some students need to like really understand them and like present them in different ways just because they're too concerned about getting through the material to pass a test. So like standardized tests aren't necessarily a problem, it's just like what the amount of material that's covered on them, because I've taken classes where tests just, there was so much that I had to know and I found that it was hard to like learn it all in as much depth as they wanted me to know it, so.
Well, just to piggyback off of that, Chris, just if you can briefly, you talked about in terms of the how this these tests and based on the data, the negative impact of it. What is a good test? I mean, you and I talked before, and mm-hmm. you said there is a good test that could work and can really measure student progress. What are a couple facets of a good test, in your opinion?
Right. So ideally, a good test is something that lets the student lead what they are learning and what they're showing, how they're showing they know it. So like Bronwyn was talking about and the podcast that she's created, that's an excellent piece of evidence for a good test of whether she's able to communicate, the folks that she has to collaborate with, her ability to think critically, and her creativeness. So that's a good test, is something that can also show that students have those skills in addition to the content knowledge. And talking about being globally ready and career and college ready for students, one of those things also that makes something a good test is to show their ability to work with people that have different perspectives and have a conversation like this. And, you know, there are ways to make sure that happens. And again, for, you know, talking about the difference between the suburban and the city schools, that is a deficit for some suburban students that doesn't show up in these tests is their ability to talk with people that have different perspectives that urban students come, you know, through our daily experience and through their daily experience have that opportunity, and that needs to be showed in a good test as well.
Adele, the RTA, they called on the city school district leaders to explain the necessary steps that parents should take if they want to opt their child out of the upcoming tests. Also thought that the district should explain to city families the rationale, intended use, and costs associated with state and federal mandated tests. How is the district responding? What type of response is the district providing, and what type of information will be available for parents?
We are sending out some information for parents, and really our motive is, and our message is, relax, rest, and do your best on these tests. And what we want parents to know is the most important thing that we want them to understand is the best instruction is every day, every classroom, giving that quality instruction. And assessment is part of instruction. Teachers do this every day. They assess their students. They get to know them as learners, as individual learners. So the standardized test is one piece. It's just one piece of many that we use to understand our students and to provide that quality instruction for our students. And I was talking to Principal Webster from School 58 yesterday about how she used this piece of standardized testing in her work. And she did analyze the 3-8 math and ELA results, and she did analyze them by standards, so she could see how her grade levels and how her teachers performed and how her students performed relative to each standard in the math and ELA standards. And so the school celebrated the strengths of that. They looked at areas for improvement, and they worked throughout this year to have new strategies and new techniques to show students different ways to show that growth. So she's excited for the students to take and challenge this exam and wants them just to rest, relax, and do their best.
And just as we close, we wrap, in terms of if parents want to opt out, is mm-hmm. the district informing them of how to do that?
Yes, so we want every parent to have a conversation with their principal, talk that through, and they'll go over all the particulars.
Bronwyn Wilkinson, Chris Widmeyer, and Adele Bovard, I appreciate your time. Thank you. And this is an issue. It's not going away anytime soon. So for continued coverage of the Common Core testing debate in the greater Rochester area, stay tuned to WXXINews.org. You may wonder, what do bicycles and art have in common? Well, it turns out a lot more than we may initially think. Museums across the country are merging these two worlds together to highlight bike culture in our society. And a new exhibit opening in Rochester this week is going a step further. Joining me now to discuss Ride It, Art and Bicycles in Rochester at the Rochester Contemporary Art Center, also called ROCO, is Blue Cease, Executive Director and Curator at ROCO, Dr. Scott McCray with the Rochester Cycling Alliance, and local artist Cordell Cordell. Bureau. And it's great to have all of you here.
Thank you. For having us.
So I know people are, you know, they might not think about art and bicycles coming together, and they might think this is an interesting idea for an exhibit. And it was when I was doing my research before this interview, I found articles about different museums really merging these two together to look at bike culture and to look at bicycles as objects of design. So talk to me a little bit about Blue, how this exhibit is encompassing that and even going a step further.
Well, there's a long history of artists engaging with the bicycle as form, bicycle as a mode of transportation or a social agent. And in the history of art, and also a lot of contemporary artists are interested in this. And also, I think there's a really strong interest from within the bicycle community. There's a strong interest in design and aesthetics. So those two things really just set the stage for us to ideally bring a lot of different groups together around this exhibition. So we made a choice from the beginning to not exhibit any actual bicycles in this show. We just knew that we couldn't do that well. This isn't really about the engineering of the bicycle or the bicycle form itself. It's more about all the stuff surrounding it, the use of bicycles as a form in a particular artist's work or as subject matter for a documentary, and the history of bicycling, so that we have a number of projects in the exhibition that deal with the history, the current moment, and the future of bicycling, specifically in Rochester.
Well, Cordell, I want to tie you into this. Art, obviously a major focal point, and you're well known for your paintings of people, and the people, I love them.
They
always look like they're having a great time. I want to be them.
I hope so.
And also the scenes, and particular scenes in your work. So how would you explain the merging of art and bicycles as an art form with the work that you're doing for this exhibit?
Well, I kind of bring the aesthetic, I suppose, like Blue was talking about, to the show. My paintings are depicting people riding bicycles and having fun, like you said. And so I'm just trying to have, we were trying to have fun with it, and there's an animation called The Triplets of Belleville, and I was kind of working off of that show to capture just having fun riding bikes and.
Well, Scott, as we've learned, it encompasses a variety of things, and bike culture and bike advocacy is also a part of this exhibit. So I'm sure people are wondering, what is bike culture? So how would you explain that first? What is bike culture in Rochester?
Well, I'm from Portland, Oregon, and their bike culture is really big. They have a whole month of just all sorts of bike festivals, essentially, and it's really evolved. And so what we've found is that the successful cities that develop biking, those are the cities that attract millennials, the best and the brightest. Young people want to bike and walk. They want to be in a bike walk friendly environment, and so mayors are competing all over the country for that. One of the things that we learned in Portland basically was that you have to develop the bike culture as well, and what Blue and Cordell are doing are helping to kind of develop that joy that we get from bicycling, and that feeling of freedom. You know, if you go back when you were a kid, you know, that being able to ride your bike was one of the great feelings of freedom and enjoyment that we all had, and it's a very emotional thing. And the beauty of the art that we see evokes that type of thing too. So the combination is kind of magical.
So talk about how bike culture makes its way into this exhibit.
Well, bicyclists have always been interested in bike art, and we're actually very thirsty for it. And Blue came up with this great idea of sort of combining bike art with the biking community, because it is growing very significantly over the past few years. You want to talk a little bit about it?
Yeah. Well, what I think what's unique about this project is we've tried to both include artists who are doing representational artworks that have to do with bicycling and bike culture, but we also tried to engage with a number of organizations who can kind of round out the conversation. The Genesee Center for the Arts does this really cool project every year called Spokes in Ink, which engages with a lot of graphic artists, and they make all these bike-related posters. So we kind of did a best of that in our exhibition. And then both the U of R Rare Books and Special Collections Library and the local history division of the public library each created these really fascinating exhibits, small displays about the history of bicycling in Rochester. Very, you know, kind of little known stories about the early context of bicycling. At one time, Rochester was known as the bicycling center
in
the country.
I mean, we had Side Path magazine, a national magazine. Yeah. Exactly. In the late 1890s, early 1900s, I learned about that.
Yeah. So we try to bring together a documentary element, a fine art element, historical context, film and video, to kind of round out the conversation, hopefully bringing these different communities, these different parts of bike culture in Rochester, all together in one space. The Contemporary Arts Center is not a bike organization per se, but we're interested in this topic for this time, and we can hopefully create some new conversations.
Cordell, I have to ask you, are you a cyclist? Do you bike?
I do bike. So yes.
So how did you approach your work? I mean, in terms of the work that you did for this exhibit, how did you approach it?
I tried to look historically, like looking at how the bike developed through time, and that's where I went with it. I picked different bikes, you know, through different eras, and so that's how I approached it.
Well, exciting exhibit to see, and I look forward to checking it out myself. And Cordell Cordero, Dr. Scott McCray, Blue Seas, thank you so much for your time. And you can learn more about Ride It, Art and Bicycles in Rochester, opening this weekend at ROCO, running through May 15th. Just go to rochestercontemporary.org. Local stories that have yet to be told. That's what you can expect from area filmmakers in the upcoming Fast Forward Film Festival. There's a catch. All the films have a common theme, the environment, and a certain time frame, 5 minutes or less. To learn more about this debut festival and the call to action organizers hope it will create, I'm joined by Dr. Andrew Stern, founder of the Fast Forward Film Festival, and Stan Main, chairperson of Rochester Movie Makers. And it's great to have you both here.
Great to be here.
So just to begin, there are a number of film festivals in the Rochester area. So talk to me a little bit about, Andy, your decision. You're the founder of the festival. Why throw your hat into the ring and introduce this festival in Rochester?
My organization, the Lost Bird Project, is a nonprofit, and we're filmmakers. So we are already into that medium. But what I wanted to do was something local. As I travel around the country and meet lots of environmental concerned people and workers, there's a tremendous concern, interest, large numbers of wonderful people, but it's local. It's local, and it seems to me nothing much is going to happen right now at a national level. So I said, I'm from Rochester, let's do it local. And so the really unique thing about the festival is the films are all made by us. You have to live in Rochester to submit a film. So the festival is of Rochester, by Rochester, for Rochester, and the hope is to bring the community together, the artists, the environmentalists, and introduce people and who otherwise wouldn't meet. And I think that's happening. I'm very excited.
So we've got various types of films that are part of this festival: live action, animation, experimental, and documentary. They were all encouraged to submit for this. And is there a sense on your end, I'm interested from both of you, that films focusing on the environmental issues of our time are not being produced as much as other topic areas?
I would say it's kind of a challenging sort of genre to get into. Zombie films work real easy. I mean, it's hard to make money with them. It's harder to make money with documentaries, period, than a good zombie film or an action film. So I think in that sense, it's a little challenging. So this gives people that want to dabble in that area a chance to do the work and actually be seen by people other than filmmakers, which is what this film festival is doing for people that are in the groups that I work with, the Rochester Movie Makers. There's a lot of people that make films, and one of the things that you really want to do after you spend all the time making the film is have somebody besides another filmmaker actually see the film. And that's what this festival has done for several of the Rochester Movie Makers group.
I was just going to say, I love film as a genre to present environmental issues. I think in this country, a lot of the way we talk about the environment isn't very helpful. It's abstract, it's political, it's polarizing. But when you watch a film that is from the heart and soul of the filmmaker, a person who cares deeply about what they're filming and expressing that, it's very compelling to nearly everybody. The things we care about, we take care of. Our children, right? We love our children, the deepest kind of caring. We take care of them. If we come to connect, engage, and care about the environment, we'll take care of it. So
Well, talk about who are the filmmakers. I know I've heard that some of these are untold stories that we haven't heard about in Rochester. So are you able to give us a glimpse into one of those stories without giving it all away?
Well, one of the Rochester Movie Makers does a 72-hour film competition every January that coincidentally is challenging filmmakers to make a five-minute film in 72 hours. So this year we allowed any filmmaker that wanted to enter, and there were 20 teams that entered this year, we allowed any of those teams the option of you get a character, a situation, and a prop, and this year we said you can take your, if you're not happy with your character that you're randomly assigned, you can automatically opt out for the environment as your character. So we had a couple of three films do that, and I think one of them got accepted. And so that film was made by RIT freshman who has been entering our 72-hour film competition with animation films for at least 3 years, and usually, if not winning, coming in second place. So, and that was the film, one of the films that's coming up. It's a stop motion piece that's going to have a lot of people talking. Maybe in the running for one of the big cash prizes.
Well, Andy, talk to me about one of the goals. I know it's to foster a new way of thinking when it comes to telling stories, receiving information about climate issues, different environmental perspectives. What's the ultimate outcome for you with this festival? How do you gauge, yes, this was a success? You know, people got it. They understood it.
Great question. I'm not sure of the answer. One of the things that we're doing is we're already organizing what's next. After the film is over, which will be the evening of April 18th at the George Eastman House, once the award ceremony is over and the dust is settled, we're immediately going to regroup and say, well, what about next year? Was this effective? Was this powerful? Was this community building? And then move on.
Well, very good. We definitely look forward to this. So Stan Main and Dr. Andy Stern, as you prefer, thank you for joining me. And you can learn all about the Fast Forward Film Festival. It's on April 17th and 18th here in Rochester. Go to fastforwardrock.org. And that is it for this edition of Need to Know. I'm Helene B. and Duty Hofer. Thank you for joining me tonight and throughout the weekend. And thank you for your support of news and public affairs programming on WXXI. I'll see you next week.